I wish that The Amazing Spider-Man 2 wasn't so derivative. Sorry, I'm coming off a little harsh. Perhaps you'd prefer tonally bipolar or thematically lazy. Yeah, I'm really not pulling any punches with this one. The Amazing Spider-Man 2 is incredibly frustrating. Because when you look at it on paper, you've got a lot of good things going on. You've got strong stars with good chemistry, and yet all of that is undermined by the lack of consistency in your world, and the fact that none of it really feels original. Like, I'm barely even talking about plot on this one. Although I will give The Amazing Spider-Man 2 some points for not just being a lazy copy-paste like the first one was. Like, in so many cases, there are just cosmetic switch-ups to make you believe that you're seeing something new. A character opposed to Spider-Man with a public platform, surrogate father figure turned evil, and even the enemy beats mirror one another. Pressure from the higher-ups, turning yourself into a monster, going after the middleman, and then seeking out Spider-Man. Can you tell I wasn't a fan of The Amazing Spider-Man? But hey, Amazing Spider-Man 2, Andrew Garfield, he's good as a sarcastic Spider-Man. Right? But the real problem with The Amazing Spider-Man 2 is that we're constantly shifting gears but never getting into drive. Gwen Stacy, Peter Parker scenes feel very much like 500 Days of Summer, which, you know, it makes sense because Mark Webb's directing them. But that cutesy kitsch is quickly countered by Jamie Foxx in the first half of the movie seeming like he just walked off the set of Batman Forever. Then the action's trying to be all epic with its destruction porn. It just would have been so nice if the movie knew what it was. But that's not the only place that the film is muddled. It's also thematically confused beyond all heck. Like, I understand that reusing with great power comes great responsibility would be a bit lazy, but it's not really any better when they just ape DC's game. The What is a Hero question was done really well in the Dark Knight trilogy, and then subsequently done again in the Man of Steel. So then Sony has to have pretty big balls to ask the question, what is a hero? He's a symbol. A symbol for what? A symbol for hope. Well, where we're from, that's a symbol for a spider. It's frustrating because they spent so much time on this whole hope symbol thing, which is fine. I mean, who doesn't like a movie's themes and motifs overtly told to them? But maybe some of that time could have been spent, polishing up the plot a little bit, strengthening our characters, you know, making the movie worth watching again. Character motivations for our villains is paper thin. In both Max and Harry's cases, they feel betrayed by Spider-Man when Spider-Man didn't really owe them anything. But when they become bad guys, oh man, they're bad guys, and they're just bad guys. They're not fun bad guys. They're like snarly, angry bad guys. And so much of this movie's plot is propelled by coincidence or just because logic. Like, how convenient is it that things start to go awry for Harry when he's right next to the Green Goblin armor? Or that there's a secret train lab that Oscorp doesn't know about but was funding the research that Peter Parker's dad was doing just because? This movie isn't cause and effect. This is cause and just because. And why can't we have scenes that hold and have resonance for our characters? When Gwen dies, we just skip 5 months into the future. And if you're wondering why we would skip over Peter at his lowest, I can tell you. Characters aren't important, but brand building is. The main issue that perpetuates this franchise reboot is that rather than focusing on the movie that we're making, we always seem to be thinking one movie ahead. So much of this movie is devoted to teases of the Sinister Six and, oh, this character might do something later. Why don't we just focus on the movie that we're making? And now for some thoughts on Gwen's death and fan service. First of all, let's not so heavily foreshadow it. The moment that Gwen Stacy's graduation speech was about how we need to cherish each moment, I immediately knew that she was going to die. And then it just became a matter of when and how is it going to happen. That's not fun for anybody. And then when we finally are dealing with that when and how, those things shouldn't be arbitrary. The fact that Green Goblin shows up at the very end basically to just kill Gwen comes off as really cheap. It's almost as though screenwriters Kurtzman and Orci were almost done with the script but suddenly remembered that Peter needed to be single in The Amazing Spider-Man 3 so he could have some weird relationship with Black Cat or something. And then they looked at their source material and were like, oh, Green Goblin killer, so let's make that happen. But like, not completely. We're only gonna do partial fan service here. We will give you the Green Goblin, but we won't give you the Brooklyn Bridge. Instead, we'll give you a clock tower because, you know, like, symbolism of time and hope and secrets and just because. There could have been a creative happy medium between Gwen's death in the comics and the movie that we were seeing in The Amazing Spider-Man 2, but instead the whole event just feels like a slapdash afterthought. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be ranty. This movie just bums me the hell out. A lot of potential, a lot of fun moments, but everything just gets lost by the film trying to do too much. The Amazing Spider-Man 2 is just kind of caught in its own web. And yes, that's a pretty forced pun, but it's just about as forced and frustrating as this movie. So those were some of my thoughts on The Amazing Spider-Man 2. Leave your thoughts in the comments down below. And of course, if you'd like more from me, you can check out previous reviews, like my thoughts on Alien and Aliens, or maybe even check out one of my movie talks. And of course, if you're feeling so inclined, you can always follow me on Facebook and Twitter. So comment, click, and keep loving movies, guys. As for me, well, let's go through some of the other similarities between Spider-Man and The Amazing Spider-Man. Peter is talking to the romantic interest who turns away from him before he is bitten by the radioactive spider. Peter embarrasses a bully in high school. And this one's just a little crazy. Uncle Ben dies at approximately the 45-minute mark in both films. Poor Uncle Ben.